So we were rolling into on Sunday last week, we were rolling, coming from Gretna, and I looked at the odometer on the van. I go, hey, let's see how far we went on this trip. And they pulled out the rental certificate, and we wanted to see, you know, just what's the total number of miles that this particular van put on. And I started thinking, I looked at the number, and I did the math, and I go, there's no way we put almost 4,000 miles on this van in 1 week. I was thinking maybe 2,500 or something like that. And then it clicked in my brain that I had had that van for over 2 weeks because we did back-to-back middle school and high school mission trips this year. So if you're wondering who I am standing before you, my name is Chad. I'm the youth director here at the Water's Edge. I've been gone for the last 3 Sundays because I've been hanging out with all these kids in yellow and green and blue shirts, and maybe somebody wore a white one today too. I haven't seen all of them, but we just got back from 2 weeks of mission trips. Our middle schoolers went to Kenosha, Wisconsin, and then our high schoolers went to Pasadena, Texas. And the realization that I had we had a 12-hour layover is what I'm going to call this, back in Omaha after we got back from the middle school trip, is that I went from the banks of Lake Michigan to the coast of the Gulf in less than 48 hours in a caravan of starting with 3 vans and a trailer to seven vans and a trailer and a truck and another trailer. So if my brain isn't quite back in order yet, I apologize. It takes a little bit of time, but we had 2 amazing trips, and I always get back from mission trips and I say, hey, who would like to talk? Like, we're going to get to share with our church about what the trips were like next week. And I'd really love it if some of you would want to share. Yeah, that's what it usually sounds like. Just like crickets, right? And this year, I prepped our students as we were leaving Houston. I was like, if any of you want to share, and immediately I'm getting text messages. I want to share, I want to share, I want to share. I'm like, I've never had this many kids share. So we're going to be here for a while, just let you know. But you're going to get to hear some really cool stories. And I want to start out by saying, never have I left a man behind on a mission trip before. And it almost happened this year. And when I say left behind, we almost left without a student from Omaha this year. We were getting ready, and everybody's checking off the list, and it's like, hey, Tori's not here. I'm like, no, Tori's here. I've seen Tori. I know she's here. No, really. And I looked, and we had everybody come in. I looked, and I go, Tori's really not here. And we called her phone, and she didn't answer, and she didn't answer, and she didn't answer. So literally, we got a hold of her mom, and her mom's like, what do you mean she's not there? She's supposed to be there. And I go, we know she's supposed to be here. She's not here. And we get on the phone talking to her mom, and she's like, I go, can you go get her and see if she's in her room? She goes, well, I'm in Alabama. Well, that doesn't help. So the neighbor went over and sprayed water all over the front of the house, thinking that that was going to wake her up inside. We ended up over there banging on the door, finally woke her up. Her mom told us how we could break into the house, got met by her newfie. That was awesome. Hey, we're going on a mission trip, and now I have dog slobber all over my face. And you'll get to hear, we didn't get to shower for 2 days, so that was even better. And then finally Tori comes down the steps. Now, you got to understand, Tori's going to be our first to share with us, and I decided that she gets to be the first to share because she was the last one to show up for the trip. So we got her in the van, and this is Tori.
I made sure to set a few alarms so I'd be here today. Each year that I've been on a mission trip, I've gotten something different out of it. The first year that I went on a mission trip, I really discovered my faith and that I really do believe in God. The second year I went on a mission trip, I learned that even when it seems like everything's going wrong and no one on your crew wants to work and you have a million things that you have to accomplish and there's no time to do it, that God has a plan, and if you trust Him, then things will happen the way that they're supposed to happen. This year, what I got out of it was really fitting with our theme. The theme for this week was in relationship and learning about being in a relationship with God. And that was so fitting for this trip because that's really what I got the most out of this week was new relationships. This year we went on our mission trip through UM Army instead of through group who we normally go on trips with. None of us really knew what to expect, and there were a lot of changes, and it was a lot of changes that we really had to take some time to get used to. We spent almost no time together as a youth group. We didn't have very much free time compared to how we normally do, and we spent almost all of our time with our work crews. We also did a lot of construction work and very little painting. So during service one night, Mac, the camp director, was talking about how in order to have a relationship with God, it really is a relationship, and how you have to put in the work in order to get anything out of that relationship. And that you can't just say, okay, God, I want to be in a relationship with you and wait for something to happen. And I feel like I really took that message to heart because I've been that person so many times where I'll pray and I'll say, okay, God, I'm ready. I want a relationship with you. I want to grow closer to you. But then I just sit around and wait for something to happen. And I don't change anything that I'm doing, and I wait and I wait and I wait, and it seems like nothing's changing. And what I never really wanted to admit was that to go further in my relationship with God, I had to do things that I didn't normally do. I had to go out of my comfort zone and change up my routine. And I think that's what makes mission trips so life-changing, is because you're thrown into this brand new routine where you're doing a bunch of things that you've never done before, and you're forced to allow yourself to just be vulnerable. This week, I was doing a lot of things that I was not comfortable with. I was doing a lot of construction-based problems, and I've never picked up a drill before last week. I was spending all of my time with my work crew instead of coming back to wherever we were staying and finding my friends immediately and spending the rest of the night with them. And it was just a lot of change that we all had to get used to. It was a week full of vulnerable moments, moments that ranged from using a jigsaw to level off some fascia boards that Wolf and I had just put up, to sitting in the pews during after worship with Pat and Lexi and just opening up my fears and insecurities and my dreams and my hopes for the future, and really just opening up a new side of me that I don't normally let people see. And that's kind of when I realized that it takes those moments in order for you to grow in any relationship, but especially in your relationship with God. And that if you're not willing to go out of your comfort zone and allow yourself to have these vulnerable moments, then that's not going to change anything in your relationship with Him. And I think that the best part of what I learned from this week is it doesn't take a week at camp or becoming a sobbing mess on cry night, even though we all do it, to grow further in our relationship with God. We all have small steps that we can take that'll push us to grow closer to Him, rather than just waiting for Him to do all the work for us. And that the more that we take these small steps, the easier it gets. And if we can keep taking those, then we just grow closer and closer to God. And that'll eventually affect all of our other relationships as well. Mac had also said one night that it isn't necessarily some huge sign that shows God's love, but the little things. Whether it's a friend listening to you when you're upset, or seeing your resident's face when she sees her house that you've been working on all week long. And that if you can start seeing the little things that add up to show God's love and keep taking those vulnerable moments and pushing yourself out of your comfort zone one step at a time, then your relationship with God will continue to grow and it'll never stop.
We had a number. Tori has graduated. She's heading down to Lincoln this fall. And really, like, she was the last person we ever expected to not show up. She's probably in 20 years of youth ministry, she calls me out on things. She's more responsible. Well, I don't know if I'm setting the bar high, but she's more responsible than me. And so we were so glad you were able to make it on the trip. Thanks for sharing with us this morning. One of the other things is when seniors are the ones that say we want to share, you can't say no to the seniors. So Nathan is another one of our seniors. Nathan is a student that I can always go to and I can say, okay, tell me what's going on. Tell me how kids are feeling. Tell me what your perception is. And Nathan doesn't usually sugarcoat it, which is why I think his story is pretty cool from the trip. When you get to meet somebody, you get to hear what they have to say and hear what their experience is like. When you get somebody like Nathan that gets to share about it, it's usually pretty cool. So.
All right, so this is my fourth mission trip with this church, and I think the mission trips have probably the favorite part of mine about youth group and church. You know, you spend 9 days with people, everyone's kind of sweaty, nobody smells great. By the end of it, you know, you're kind of tired of each other, but you get home, and you had a great time, and I can speak for a lot of people, we're all ready to do it again. I would go back there in a heartbeat and do it all over again. Probably my favorite part about mission trips is getting to meet your resident. They're old, you know, elderly, or they're a disabled veteran, so they can't do the work themselves. But they're so happy you're here, and, you know, you're not doing as good of a job on things as you like because you don't have as much time. You don't have the skills that, you know, like a real construction company would do. But the residents, they usually tend to be okay with all the work you're doing, even if it doesn't look perfect to you. They're happy that someone's there to hang out with them and speak to them. My resident this year, his name was Alex. He was really friendly and very open with us. He was outside the entire time we were working, just talking to us, giving us suggestions if we were stuck on a task. One of the things he said to me it was actually the first day he told me this. He said every morning he wakes up and he thanks God for his day, and then he tells God that whenever God's ready, he's ready to go. And I thought about that right away, and it was very sad to me because, you know, I'm 18, a lot of life left to live, a lot of things I want to accomplish and do. So, like, I'm not ready to die at this moment, you know. I was working later in that day, and then I realized kind of like the way he was like looking at that and the way he was thinking about his life is that he's putting all of his faith and all of his trust in God so that when it's God chooses to take Alex to heaven, that he's ready and he knows that God's going to take care of him and he's going to spend the rest of his time in heaven in this perfect place. And that kind of changed how I looked at that week and how I plan on looking at the rest of my life, is that even if you're not ready to go because you still have a lot of stuff you want to accomplish, that you should always put all of your faith and all of your trust in God, and that if you do that, that God's going to do some amazing things through you, and you're going to just live this amazing life through God because you're putting all of your faith and your trust in Him.
So, Nathan, I think of the students that I've talked to, you're probably going about the furthest away of our graduates this year.
Yeah, I think it's about 8 hours.
That's a huge leap of faith. Like, how does what your resident told you about, you know, not even just God, I'm ready when you are, I don't think it's necessarily always just about when God wants to say this is the end of your life on earth, but when God says, I'm ready for you to do this, when I'm ready for you to do that, how does that impact you as you get ready to head off to college?
So I'm probably about a month out from heading to college, this whole summer I've been really excited about it. Like, I get to go to this new state, and I get to experience new things, and I get to learn and study about something I'm really excited about. But as I've, like, kind of realized it, I've kind of realized that, like, I'm so far away, you know, a lot of people can just come home for the weekend, but, like, I'm probably going to come home, you know, on breaks, and that's probably about it. So, like, I think God's, like, I'm definitely have to put a lot of, like, faith and trust in God that, like, I'm going to be really far away from my family, and it's going to be different, like, having to, like, do all this stuff on my own and not having, like, my parents there to help me out. I'm just going to put all of my faith and trust in God because I know that, like, I'm where He wants me to be and that I'm just going to do some great things through Him.
Cool. Thank you. So you get to hear from seniors, but I think hearing from our younger students is also really cool. Sometimes they get challenged to come forward and talk, and Amanda right away said, I want to talk. And then I said, okay, what do you want to talk about? I didn't hear right away, and then I heard, oh, I want to talk about this. So I'm going to ask you a few questions, if that's all right. Amanda is going to be a freshman in high school this year at Elkhorn. Right?
Elkhorn South.
She just went through confirmation and went on a couple of middle school trips, but this was your first high school trip. Why did you want to go on a high school mission trip?
I really wanted to serve others and show them Christ's love through this week.
Okay. And what was a highlight of the trip for you?
Getting to know our resident was really cool, and getting to talk to her and seeing everyone grow in their relationship with Christ throughout the week.
And what was the story with your resident? Who was she? What did she, what were you doing for her?
We were replacing her siding and painting her house, and she was just really nice, and it was nice to get to know her and stuff.
So what was the way that you were challenged on the trip? Trips aren't always easy, right? It's not like fun and games, and I mean, there's some, but not a lot. What was the way that you were challenged on this trip?
When we didn't get to hang out with our youth group as much, and we had to, like, meet other people, was
not everybody that goes on a mission trip or is like super outgoing and wants to, you know. And that was, I noticed a couple of times during the trip, like one thing I've noticed just about Amanda in general is that she's a lot more thoughtful. She's a lot more contemplative about things. And like throughout the week, during like worship times at night, I would see you sitting there, and sometimes you looked a little emotional. Other times you just looked like you were trying to process stuff. What kind of was some stuff that went through your mind and that you experienced emotionally through like the worship and through the experiences this week?
I think I was mostly thinking about like my relationship with God and how I wanted it to grow that week and like my goals for it.
So what were some of those goals?
Praying to him more and trusting that he had the right plan for me and that I would just trust that.
And did that happen?
Yeah.
How did you grow this week or last week or the week before?
I trusted God a lot more and that he would do the right thing for me. And I didn't, like, try and control my plan for, like, my life. And I let him do it.
Steve, one of our leaders, kept saying over and over and over the week, every time something didn't happen the way we all thought it was going to happen, you know, you can set your goals, but God's the one that determines your steps, right? And did you experience that this week, huh?
Yeah.
So what made this trip worth it for you?
Seeing everyone grow in their relationship with Christ and, like, realizing that my relationship with him grew a lot.
Thank you very much. So this is Chantley. Chantley is, I have a hard time thinking of a mission trip that you haven't been on, but you wrote out your talk. All right, good. Well, yep. I don't have to introduce anything because you've got it all right there for you. You got this?
Yep.
All right.
Yes. Okay. So this was my third mission trip this year. I was praying for weeks that this trip would lead me to God, and it did. It did. During this week, this message was about relationships and building relationships. And I definitely did. I built relationships with my crew members. I built relationships with God. And I built relationships with my resident and then people from the water's edge. Also, my resident this week was Mary Rodriguez. And she was affected by the hurricane that happened about this time, I think, last year. My crew and I had to put in a lot of work to fix Mary's house. On the first day we got to Mary's site, their neighbors weren't hesitant to come over and tell us to park in their driveways because it was a busy street. They just came over and asked if we needed anything, and they were just really, really nice. Now, one of Mary's neighbors I got to know well was Janie. And Janie was the most caring person who welcomed us to her home as we worked outside. She insisted to our crew to eat on her porch that was shaded. She gave us all her kitchen chairs, brought them outside. She gave us a fan. She gave us her own little tablecloth. She gave us some watermelon. She gave us some lemonade. And she just welcomed us to our home like she knew us forever. As I got to know her this week, she told me that her husband died 7 years ago and that all her children moved out. So she has been living home alone for a long time. But something that stood out for me was that she said, "I have one relationship that has never failed, and that relationship is God." And I thought that was pretty cool because our message this week was all about relationships, but she had no idea. She just said that one relationship never failed was God. So as we got to build on our house, we had to fix Mary's siding. As we took the siding off, the wood and was completely destroyed by termites in the mold. So that we had to fix. I got to use a circular saw for my first time. So that was interesting. And this week, I realized that God has been with me all along. There may have been a lot of ups and downs from the water's edge not showering for 3 days, and then to me seeing a spider and then falling out of the shower and pulling the shower curtain down, and then half my crew getting heat exhaustion. But God showed me that even through the hard times, he is always with us. Like Janie said, God is the one relationship that will never fail and that I will have for the rest of my life. Even when going through the thick part of life, God is always there to put you back on your feet.
So it was a spider that caused you to try and rip down somebody else's shower curtain?
I was spraying it, and then I kind of slipped and I fell.
For, We left at, well, we were supposed to leave at 6 a.m. on Saturday morning, which means that most of the students, they had to be there at 5, which means that most of them did not shower that Saturday morning. And the next time most of us saw a shower was Monday afternoon after getting into our work sites. So you can imagine our rooms and the vans. We were all pretty ripe by the time we got around to that. But thanks for sharing. Riley Cordes is another one of our seniors. Riley, your first mission trip was 7 years ago in St. Louis. And you've been on a couple of middle school trips and a couple of high school trips. Share a little bit about your experience this year.
All right, so as he said, I've been on multiple mission trips. So just starting off, I have relied on God a lot this year. It's been a really rough year for me. So this trip really was something that needed to happen. So Chad had been asking me multiple times, like, are you going to come? Are you going to come? I was like, I don't know. Like, I don't know. I just had to think about it. And so my dad and my sister and my brother were already going on it. So I was like, I don't know if I want to do that. So so then a month before the trip, I was at church, and Chad came up to me, and he was like, you know, I'd really mean a lot if you came on this trip, and it's a month away if you want to come. I was like, all right, I'll do it. I want to go. So I knew that was going to change my life right away. So there were too many things I could say, but the second that we got there, I was so thankful that God had put me on this trip. My crew was amazing. I was on Chanley's crew. Mary was such a sweet lady. She had a grandson that lived with her. He's about our age. He took care of her. He had a job. He was trying to restart his or fix his truck because it wouldn't start. Just he was taking care of her every day, and her neighbors were so kind, asking us to park in their driveways, bringing us out food, having us sit at their table. Just anything that they can do for us was so nice. But we did have a tough project that week, so we were just supposed to replace her front door, replace a few soffits, and take out all the siding off from the bottom row and put a new row in. Once we took off the first bottom row on Monday, we looked at the studs, and they were rotten from top to bottom. So, and they had termites all in it. So we had to take those studs, we had to take all the siding off, take all the studs out, and like redo installation, studs, siding, all that on the back of the house, on the side of the house. And then we ended up staying there till 5 on Friday night, just finishing because we wanted to complete that. And she also did get robbed a few years ago, so she, her door was like bolted in, and like we couldn't really replace the front door. But so that week did push me to be a better person. So not only did I form new relationships with people, but my relationship with God did become a lot stronger. So going off to college and not having this church 5 minutes away is going to be rough for me because it's been my home forever. So during this trip, I grew in my faith and want to continue pursuing God when I go off to college. And also now having close relationships with people from church will help me guide on the right path. And my relationships with my dad and my brother and sister did get a lot stronger. So I'm very thankful for that. And I recommend that if you've never been on a mission trip, that you push yourself. If you're a student, an adult, it is so life-changing. Or if this is your first or fourth one that you've been on, that you continue to go, because each and every one is different in its own way. And last but not least, if you want to put a hand together for everybody that put this together for us, and that all the students that went on it and all the adults that took a week off just to go and serve. So thank you.
So we had a middle school trip in there somewhere too. And you see a lot of yellow shirts. On Mission Trip Sunday, I always feel like I have to wear the middle school shirt because we took 33 on the middle school trip. We took 83 on the high school trip. So I'll represent with you guys. But I'm going to have Caleb Butler come up. Caleb is going to be a seventh grader. We, like a sixth grade, we'll take you. If you're ready to go and serve, we'll take you on a trip. But Caleb, you guys came to the Water's Edge about a year ago, right?
Yeah.
What helped you guys? What do you like about Water's Edge? What have you enjoyed about the youth group?
I've liked making new friends and then having my family to rely on and then having a whole nother church family to rely on for even more support.
That's been good for you, huh?
Yeah.
So as a result of that, like, what made you want to go on a mission trip this year?
I wanted to grow closer to Christ, and then I wanted to meet new people.
Did you meet new people on the mission trip?
Yeah, I met a lot.
Tell me about some of the people you met.
I met a whole bunch of people that were in the youth group that I didn't even know were in the youth group.
Okay.
And then all of the residents, they were really nice.
So tell us about what you did on the trip. Who did you serve? What did you do?
I was at a memory care place, and it's for people who have memory disabilities or are just having problems taking care of themselves.
So a lot of people who have things like dementia, Alzheimer's, are struggling as they get older.
Yeah.
Maybe just remembering things.
Yep.
And did you work with a lot of people there, or?
Nobody really liked me.
Like, your friends didn't like you,
oh,
or like
no.
The people at the care facility didn't?
Like the residents.
The resident. Okay, so. Okay. So who did you end up hanging out with?
I ended up hanging out with this lady that only spoke Italian.
So how'd that work out for you?
There was a lot of Google Translate, which didn't help me a whole lot.
You said you used Google Translate?
Yeah.
It didn't help though?
No, it didn't help.
So, what was her name?
Her name was Franca.
Franca?
Yeah.
Okay, she's Italian, and she doesn't speak English.
Yeah.
Did she know English? Did she?
Yeah, she understood it.
So she could understand what you were saying.
Yeah.
So when you can't talk to somebody and you're on a trip and you're trying to, and she doesn't remember you from day to day, how do you minister to her? How do you spend time with her? What did you guys do?
We played a whole bunch of bocce ball.
A whole bunch?
Yeah.
Like. Because you were there like 6 hours a day,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, we played like 15 games a day.
So if anybody wants to know how to play bocce ball, you can figure it out from Caleb over here.
Yeah.
So tell me, Caleb, what's one way that, I mean, beyond like the language barrier, what made it worth it for you to hang out with Franca? What was good about that?
She showed me around the place, and she really enjoyed praying, and so we prayed 8 or 9 times a day, and so we prayed a lot.
It's pretty cool.
Yeah.
The theme of the trip was called what?
Spiritual grit.
Okay, and what was the idea behind that?
It was growing towards Christ and putting more trust in Him, so you can go forward and do more knowing that you have Christ to rely on.
And how did working with Franca, doing the things that you did, the talks that they gave at night, how did that help you develop your spiritual grit?
It helped me understand more of what I need to do to grow towards Christ instead of drifting off to friends or school or stuff like that.
Cool. Thanks, man.
Yep.
Like Caleb said, you meet a lot of fun people on trips, and sometimes they don't even speak your language, and other times you find out that you have a lot more in common with them than you thought you did. Right, Jillian?
Mm-hmm. Okay, this is my 6th mission trip, and my story starts a year ago from this past May. I was at Children's Hospital having a 5-plus-hour surgery on my brain in school to correct a congenital abnormality that I found out I had. This condition isn't very popular. It only occurs in about 1 in every 1,000 births. So I've only met like 2 people in Omaha who even heard of the condition or known someone who had it. So at the beginning of the week of the camp, we were given a prayer bracelet with a name on it that had a person who's at the camp as well. We were told to pray for them throughout the week. And the person I received was Charles. And I knew it wasn't anyone in our youth group because I pretty much know everyone. And in the beginning of the week, I began praying for him, just generic things like safety, endurance in the heat, and growth in his relationships. And by the middle of the week, the safety team came around, and they told me that there was a family at the church that had 3 kids who had the same condition that I had. And the dad of this family was Charles. So I immediately became overjoyed and felt the biggest power of God at work I've ever felt in my life. And when I got back to camp that night, I tracked down Charles and his family and had a long conversation with him and his wife and their kids about their story and shared mine with them. We prayed for the oldest daughter because she was going to fly to New York this past week to continue her treatment for our condition. She had it a little bit more severe than I did. So throughout the week, my prayers got more genuine, hopeful, and knowing of what Charles and his family were going through. I really saw the power of God bringing us together and then just bringing this whole new relationship into my life and being able to grow and share my story. And I still feel the energy and love that I felt when I heard the similarities of my life and Charles's. I will never forget this family and the relationship I have made with them and the common ground we will always share.
Hold on to that. Yeah, I think a lot of times we get prayer requests in church and we're told somebody's got this or can you pray for me or can you do this. How did knowing specifically what you were praying for and working with somebody that you could relate to, how did that change your prayers over the course of the week?
I really understood what they were going through since I went through it myself, obviously. And it just really made the prayers more meaningful and also helped me grow in my prayer life. So that was really cool and good for me as well.
It doesn't always have to be the things that we have been through ourselves, but just the ability to connect with that person and hear their story and relate to them. And so much of our trips are about the relationships that we build. That's what the entire theme of our high school trip was about. So thank you, Jillian, for sharing about that. I think that mission trips are great. And I'll tell you over and over and over, you should go on a trip, you should go on a trip, and I'll try to get you to go on a trip. I can't ever make somebody go on a trip, but sometimes parents make their kids go on trips. And it's amazing to watch how a person's attitude and faith can change and grow over the course of the week. Isaiah.
Hello. So before this mission trip, I had no faith in God, just none. And my mom told me that. I told my mom that I'd go on the mission trip just to tell her to go on a mission trip and just get it over with. I did not want to go for many reasons. I mean, I didn't talk to anybody in the youth group. I was quiet, yeah. And I had to wake up early, and I did not want to do that. So the first day, after worship, we got the choice to go hang out with people in the gym, or we could stay in the area and pray and stuff and try to find God or talk to God and pray and stuff, whatever. And first day I just said, I don't really want to do this. I'm just going to go in the gym and hang out with people. And I really started opening up and like being myself, and I was just happy, I guess. And second day I decided to stay. I actually walked out and I didn't think I was going to go back in, but I just decided to turn around and go back in and just sit by myself in the corner and just think. And I got to thinking, and I started reading the Bible, and I started reading my old favorite verse when I had a lot of faith in God when I was in Boys Town. I don't know the verse by heart, but you know, I don't really want to find it. So I was just reading it over and over again, and like I started singing the songs that they're singing, and I was happy. I started smiling, and I just like closed my eyes, and it just clicked. I found my faith in God again, and it really meant a lot. And I don't cry, and I cried 4 out of the 5 days. Okay. And geez, third and fourth day, I mean, I was just, my faith life was thriving. I was happier than ever. I met so many different people that I actually like began to care about, and actually like just I want them to stay in my life for as long as possible. And yeah, people, I stayed in the sanctuary every day after worship, and people would come up to me and talk to me, and I went up to people and talked to them, and I cried. I don't know. It's emotional for me to think about how much I believe in God now, and how much trust I've been putting in God over the past 2 weeks, and it changed my life, because now I actually care about how people feel, and about how people want to, I actually care about how people feel, and I actually care about how people impact my life, and how I impact theirs. And I offered everybody in the youth group, and I still do, that if they ever need to talk to someone, I'm always willing to talk to them, and always willing to help them. And they offered me the same thing, and it means so much to me. But I want to go to church now. I used to just, my mom would ask me if I want to go to church, and I'd be like, nah, I'm fine. I want to sleep in. And she always wanted to go to the 9:30 service. Anyway, I just actually found my faith, and I actually want to be like with God, and I actually want to help people, and actually care about people, and that's just my story, and it means so much to me now that I actually care. So, it's my story.
There, hold on to that for a second. So I gotta be honest, like sometimes as a youth director, you get to know kids, or you meet kids, and they start coming to church, or they start coming to youth, and sometimes you can just tell, like, I don't want to be there.
Yeah, I'm gonna
sit in the corner. I'm gonna just kind of not talk to anybody, and I can tell you, like, there's been a number of times where I'll sit down and start asking Isaiah questions, and he just like, if he could actually say the words, get away from me, those would have been the words that he would have said. But about halfway through the week, maybe it was Tuesday, I saw Isaiah like just bouncing up the stairs, and I'm like, there's something. I go, Isaiah, you're different. And he looked at me, and do you remember what you said to me?
I said, if you ever see me act like I was acting, tell me to act like I am acting.
You said, something yeah, like you that. Said, this is the real me. Like, I think one of the things that just moved me this week, with you, not just you, but is when you see people start to connect with who God created them to be, and you see them open up to the possibilities that God has put in their lives, you see the kind of difference that they can make. You can go sit down. I'll wrap this up. You get to see this. Over the last couple of weeks, 116 youth and adults from the Water's Edge gave up a week or more of their summer. They gave up time at work. They gave up time with their friends. They gave up time with their family. Some of them gave up their vacation time. And then on top of that, they paid to go and serve. And you know what? Like, it's not just 116 people from our church. It's all of our church that does this. when we do a fundraiser and you participate, when we ask for your prayers by putting names in a bulletin and you choose to pray for those kids, you participate with us. You make a difference with us. And it's because of the support of this church that these lives get changed. And it's because of the support of this church that the lives that we work with get changed. And that is so much. Now, we have a lot of fun on our trips. We laugh. We work hard. And so we just wanted to show you just a couple of minutes worth of what a trip is like for us.
I was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my tomb till I met you. I was breathing but not alive. All my failures I tried to hide. It was my tomb, yeah, till I met. You call my name and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness into your glorious day. You call my name and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness. I was an orphan, now you call me a sinner.